The groovy stuff that I want to share with you is the out-of-office features. So you'll see here tomorrow afternoon, I'm going to go and do a mineral bath down in Burleigh, which I'm very excited about. And so I've set myself to be out of office for the afternoon. Now, to do that, all you need to do is drag and drop an event, just like you would create a normal event, and click the out-of-office button. There we go. So the out-of-office button, when I click save, it's got a really cool little feature here. It's going to automatically decline existing meetings and any new meetings for those times. So you know how every now and again, someone will just like drop you an email and they'll send a proposed time. If you know you're going to be out and about for the day, then just set this up and it's going to automatically save and decline any meetings. If you, for some reason, need to be away for the day or not at work for the day, you can also drag an out of office over existing meetings that you've already RSVP'd to. Stick it to out of office, and then it'll automatically decline all of those meetings that you had there. I'm not going to do these for my Thursday meetings, obviously. The one downside to this is you can't, unfortunately, schedule the out of office to be repeating. So if you've got like a repeated day out of the office, you can't quite do that, which is a bit annoying. But you can do an out of office all day event if you want. Okay, so I can set out of office to be all day, and then it's going to be automatically all day out of office. Now, where is that useful for your team members? Well, let's have a look at what that looks like on Angel's calendar. So I asked Angel to set an out of office for this evening here, and she's taken a holiday from 5 p.m. till midnight her time. And it's automatically showing me that Angel is out of the office here. Now, that's okay, kind of useful if I was to go to the calendar and want to book a meeting with her. But let's say, for example, I want to send Angel a chat message and, you know, just say hi to her or hit her up about a task or let her know that I've got a new crazy idea that I wanted to implement. That's the kind of thing that typically happens on a typical day for us. I want to message Angel via chat. So let me go ahead and I'll open my chat here. And you may have noticed this earlier if you've got a keen eye that inside my chat window with Angel, check this out. Angel is out of the office, back tomorrow. Now, if she'd been back, like let's say she scheduled out of the office for the whole week because she was away, it would say back next week or back on the 15th or whatever it is, but that automatically shows up there in the chat. The other cool thing is if, for example, I had not looked at Angel's calendar and I decided to schedule a meeting here and I added Angel as a guest, it's actually going to show, well, for starters, it's going to show that Angel is outside the working hours. But if I was to send this, it's going to automatically decline the meeting from Angel. So she doesn't even have to bother with that. But you'll see here, it's also showing that it's outside of her working hours. I was hoping it would actually show that she's out of office, but it seems to take preference that it's outside her working hours there. And that is my third tip. I want to show you guys how to set up your working hours so different people know when it is or isn't appropriate to be scheduling times with you. Particularly useful if you've got a team that are international or working across different time zones, but definitely useful for someone who's maybe outside your company trying to schedule a meeting with you. Okay, so I'm going to go to settings here, and inside settings, we want to find working hours. There we go. So you can set what days and what working hours you are available. There's a help guide here as well, but that's basically inside your Google Calendar settings, and then it's going to automatically let anyone who's able to schedule meetings with you know whether or not it's like in office or out of office hours for you. Why would it be useful? Why is it important to actually spend the time to set up this kind of stuff? Well, because it just makes your day-to-day easier. I know that when I'm messaging my team members on chat, that I'm interrupting them in some form, right? I'm giving them some kind of interruption. And I don't want to interrupt someone when it is their personal time. As business owners, for us, everything is urgent all the time. And for us, everything is on the line all the time because we own the business. If the thing fails, we might lose our family home, probably our livelihoods. We can run into real trouble, right? And so we are probably going to have a higher perception of what's actually important and or urgent than our team members will have. And we need to learn to make sure that we're giving other people space and we're giving good boundaries or we're adhering to good boundaries with the people that we work with. And so the moment that I see, oh, someone's out of office when I go to send them a random message because I've had a random thought, then I will immediately double check that and decide, okay, could this go into Asana? Is this important enough to bother someone when they've said that they're actually out of office? Or am I even going to get a response? I know that I don't need to expect a response if someone's actually out of office because I can then know, all right, they're not in today, I'll hassle someone else. So that gives you an idea of how to use those features. I really like those in Calendar. Very simple features, but again, make it really easy for you to use. Now, inevitably, we get questions from time to time. Pete, should I use Calendar on Outlook on my desktop? Or I'm on a Mac and I really, really, really like Apple Calendar. Should I synchronize it to Apple Calendar? Or I'm on an iPhone and I haven't actually downloaded the Google Calendar app and you're still using the Apple Calendar. Now, it'll synchronize both ways. It actually works, but you miss out on some of these features. And so if you are one of those people who are using a calendar other than the official Google Calendar apps and the official Google Calendar in the web, then I would strongly recommend you consider downloading the official apps and only using Google Calendar in the web. Now, not only is the web a better experience, in my opinion, but if you're actually synchronizing your Google Calendar to either your Apple Calendar on your phone, or if you're synchronizing it to Mac Apple Calendar on your Apple desktop or laptop, then you can actually run into synchronization conflicts. And look, we've got 20,000 employees that we support across all of our clients. We have seen hundreds and hundreds of customers who are using Apple Calendar and they run into synchronization issues on their Google Calendar. So just forget about it. Use Google in the web. Download the actual Google Calendar app. Do that now if you haven't already, and you're going to have a much better experience. So I'm curious to hear, drop it in the comments, guys, if that is you, if you need to go and download it. If you're downloading it right now, then let me know. I would love to know. Okay, guys, I come from a background of IT management. In the IT industry, it's called MSP or Managed Service Providers. I started this business when I was 19 years old officially, but before that, I was kind of helping people out with their computers. So it's 15 plus years that I've been helping businesses and consumers as well with their technology. Now, what I know is if there's an opportunity for something to go wrong, eventually it will go wrong. It might only be once a year, but it might be that once a year that you miss a meeting or you miss an important call with a client and that turns into rubbish for you. Now, multiply that by 5 or 10 times when you've got a bunch of staff that you've got to manage as well, then all of a sudden you're going to have that Moore's law coming into place times 5x or 10x or 20x, which is not the kind of thing that we want a 10x. And so cloud first, everything. And it's the same principle with using something like a Chromebook, which we have many other videos on our channels. Make sure that you keep things as simple as possible and you just remove the options and you remove the opportunities for things to break or for things not to work, and you're gonna have a much better time. Okay, I've got one more very quick one and then we've got a bonus one, guys, and then we're gonna wrap up. So next up, let's talk about Google Vault. I have not talked about Google Vault in a long time, and that's because it's one of those features that tends to like hide away in the background that people don't need to use until they have an OF moment. And my philosophy of life is we want to have ahas before we have OFs. And so what we're going to do with Google Vault is, first up, I'm going to show you how to switch it on because most people have not yet switched it on. And then secondly, I'm going to show you how we can actually use it if anything ever goes wrong and you need to rely on Google Vault. So why might you need to rely on Google Vault? Well, the most popular reason is that you're being sued or you're suing someone or something's gone to shit. And Google Vault keeps a carbon copy of every single email in and out of your business in a secure vault. Basically, it takes a copy as they come in or as they go out and it puts them in the vault. It also does this for your Google documents. Unfortunately, not your non-Google documents. It's only for the Google format documents, but it does it for your chats as well. Now, when you're using Google Vault, it's not a backup. A backup is something that gives you version control, different versions of files, and a backup allows you to restore really quickly. And so you should use a backup for G Suite, but Vault is not a backup. Vault is about something called e-discovery, or file or data retention. And what Vault does is it gives you a place to go to when you need to search, archive, and then export lists of communications and basically have a safety net for any piece of data in your business that may go missing. Now, what are the examples of data going missing? Well, it might be through deliberate employee misconduct. Unfortunately, we have seen this from time to time where someone will, as they're leaving the business, and you know, maybe they're not on great terms with the business owner, they'll start to delete evidence or delete emails, try and cover their tracks, or maybe they've been doing a bunch of personal junk in there and you know, maybe they're like pushing the line a little bit on boundaries on their work role. And so you have issues where people are trying to like, you know, delete data from their business account, but they accidentally delete legitimate data. Or sometimes you just have accidents. Most data loss is actually caused by human interaction. It's actually just human error. And so someone might be thinking that they're doing the right thing by trying to clean up their Google Drive and they accidentally delete some files that they shouldn't have, and then they go to their bin, they empty the bin, and then it's gone. So Google Vault will basically keep a copy of everything that's in there. And the magic little feature that Google Vault has is that you can do one search across all of the inboxes right across your business. So if you're looking for a set of emails, you can actually look right across the whole business and see every single email that's come or gone from that person inside the business. So let's go and have a look at what that looks like.